Well, good morning. I thought Paul was going to go on for a little bit longer and I was going to have nothing to speak on because he stole some of the things I wanted to say. But I am so thankful to be here and excited to be here and share with you for the last 6 weeks. About the last 6 weeks, Paul and Brad and Chris have been teaching on being called. And I don't know about you, but I am starting to feel the challenge and excitement to know exactly where God is calling me. Now, Paul mentioned that he asked me to speak today, and I have to say that my first answer was not an absolute yes. And I will be honest, though, I felt after 6 weeks of hearing about being called, I wasn't sure how to say no. And so I don't want you to think it was easy. Just to tell you a little bit about me, I serve in a women's Bible study with 500 women, and I have the privilege of teaching regularly there. I also teach our wonderful grade 1 to 5s every other month. But this felt bigger. And my answer to Paul changed over the time since he asked me. One day it was yes, and then it was no, and then it was yes, and then it was no, and yesterday it was really no. But obviously it was too late, and so here I am. And I'm excited, though. I am excited to be able to share how God has taught me. Now, I need to give a little disclaimer, because I do teach women and children. So you men in the audience, if you don't understand what I'm saying, then turn to the woman on your right or the child on your left, and they will give you some clarification. Okay? So, I too would like to welcome the children here. I am so excited that I didn't get to miss being with you because this is my month of teaching. It was actually Janelle and Kristen who said, okay, you can teach upstairs, but you're taking all the children with you. And so that's why they're up here today. Just kidding. It is our family Sunday. Now, you guys have that bulletin so you can follow along with what is happening. I would also like to welcome our missionaries. It is so great to have you here. I know that some of you are here every week and some of you are not. And I am so looking forward to spending some time with you afterwards and just hear how God is working in each of the areas that you are working in. I shared with you the challenge I found myself in as I obeyed God's call to come up and speak. Have you ever found yourself in a situation where you thought, I cannot handle this? What am I going to do? I can't get through this. Well, today we're going to look at Joshua chapter 1. And Joshua is in exactly this situation. Moses, who was his longtime mentor and friend, has died, along with his whole generation, except for Caleb. And God is now calling Joshua to lead his people, the Israelites, in to battle and conquer this rich, rich land of Canaan. Can you imagine how he felt? I'm sure he was feeling inadequate. He was confused. He was terrified. But God sees Joshua. God knows him, and he loves him. And he speaks words of comfort and confidence in Joshua's life. And God also sees you and I. By looking at Joshua's story, we will learn that God promises his people strength to obey his word. We will be reminded that God keeps his promises to his people. God supplies all of Joshua's needs to courageously fulfill his calling. And that promise-keeping Lord will do the same for you and I. So if you are feeling the same conviction that I am after hearing these messages of the last 6 weeks, you can draw on the strength and confidence that comes only from God, the creator of the universe, the one who will equip you as he calls you. So let's start off by setting a little bit of context for this Joshua chapter 1. First of all, who is Joshua? Well, I want to tell you five things about Joshua, and they all start with the letter S. He is a slave, he is a soldier, he is a servant, a spy, and a successor. Now let's go through those again quickly. He was a slave. Joshua was born when the Israelites were in slavery in Egypt. His parents named him Hosea, which means salvation, and then Moses changed his name to Joshua, which means the Lord saves. As a young man, Joshua saw God do signs and wonders in order to deliver Israel from Pharaoh's bondage. The next time we hear about Joshua, he has become a soldier. In Exodus chapter 17, Joshua is the military leader who is helping to battle the Amalekites. And we hear how Moses prayed with his arms held high by Aaron and Hur as Joshua was down below leading the army in battle. Joshua was a servant. He was Moses' assistant for 40 years. He was also a spy. He was among the 12 spies in that first group to go into the promised land under Moses' direction. And he, with Caleb, gave that really bold minority report saying, we can trust God. We can take this land. And finally, he is a successor. That means that he was the next in line to lead the people. Joshua was God's appointed leader to come after Moses. And listen, God has been preparing Joshua for 40 years. So if you have your Bibles with you, you might want to open them up or turn them on or grab the Bible in the pew. And we're turning to Joshua chapter 1. And we are going to look at the first 11 verses. So Israel's camp is set up on the plains of Moab. The Israelites have been wandering in the wilderness for the last 40 years as God prepared them to enter the land of Canaan, the land that he had promised them. Their leader, Moses, has died. And so after 30 days of mourning Moses' death, all those eyes that were red from weeping now turn to Joshua in fearful expectation and anticipation. In the first four verses, we will see how God appoints Joshua. And I want to read from verses 1 and 2. It says, after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord said to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' aide, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now then, you and all these people get ready to cross the Jordan River into the land I am about to give to them, to the Israelites. Well, this book begins with an abrupt and shocking statement that Moses is dead. And to make matters worse, standing between them in this land is a river. Now, God knows Joshua's anxiety. He also knows the fear and grief of the Israelites. And God addresses their apprehension and their doubt head on. God gives them promises. What he is really saying here is get these people ready to go. Get them ready to take the land that I am giving them. Now, God's promise of land, it comes before Joshua, even Moses. The roots of Joshua chapter 1 are buried and sunk deep in Genesis chapter 12, where God promised this land to Abraham. Joshua is God's chosen leader, but he must lead according to God's plans and promises. God's plans succeed not due to the achievement of great men, but they succeed on the great promises of a great God. The work of God is not dependent on a particular leader. The book of Joshua shows us how God's promises are fulfilled. He simply appoints a new leader. And the key here is the faithfulness of God. It is all about God. And this gives us the confidence that we need to serve. It is not about what we do. It is not about who we are. God controls the outcomes. We serve him wholeheartedly, knowing that he is in control. Now, knowing the fear and anxiety of his people, God restates the promise that he gave to Abraham. As we look at verses 3 and 4, it says, I will give you every place where you set your foot as I promised Moses. Your territory will extend from the desert to Lebanon and from the great river, the Euphrates, all the Hittite country to the great sea on the west. The you in these verses is actually plural. He is giving these promises to the people of Israel. He specifically outlines the land he will give them. God knows. God knows the fear and anxiety of the Israelites, as he also knows our fears and our anxieties. He knows that when he calls us, we need courage to obey. But listen, your courage will rise when you have confidence in that call. And why is that? It's because of this truth. God fulfills his promises. God fulfills his promises. What difficult situation are you facing that causes you to wonder if you could ever do what God called you to do? As adults, youth, and children, we all face difficult things. Maybe you're having a hard time at school. Or maybe your parents have just told you that you have to move. Maybe your friends at high school are choosing very different things than what you would like to do. Perhaps there's been job loss or health issues in your family. My friend Matthew shared with me last week that he had seen a sign that said, "No pillow is as soft as God's promises." And Matthew asked me, what that mean? What does that mean? And so Matthew and I agreed that sleeping on a really soft pillow is amazing. It's the best feeling. We sleep better, we feel more rested. And then as we talked a little further, we decided that what the sign was saying is that God's promises are the best. We can rely on his promises, we can count on them, and they will give us peace. Just like a good night's sleep. I want to encourage you after the service to spend time with our missionaries, and I want you to ask them about the obstacles that they faced as they followed God's call for their lives. I want you to listen to them and hear how God gave them strength and courage to follow his call. In verses 5 to 9, we will see how well God knows Joshua and knows us as he strengthens him and encourages him to be strong and courageous. Let's look at verses 5 to 6. It says, "No one will be able to stand up against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Be strong and courageous, because you will lead these people to inherit the land I swore to their forefathers to give them." In these verses, we see three promises. Just in verse 5, "No one will be able to stand against you, I will be with you, and I will never leave you or forsake you." God lifts our vision and lifts Joshua's vision from our own inadequacies and up onto him and his complete sovereign authority in the world. God is in control. God never calls us to do anything apart from him. I am sure that Joshua never anticipated such a life of spiritual leadership. And I am sure that our missionaries never anticipated how God has called them. God calls each of us to serve, but we need encouragement. God tells Joshua over and over again, be strong and courageous. In God's power, by the might of his word, the Bible, Joshua could and would lead Israel into this land that he had promised their ancestors. In verse 6, we see how God adds that Joshua's success will be because God will act on his behalf. God will do it. God controls the outcomes. Now we move on to verse 7 and 8. We see how God tells Joshua to be strong and courageous. But he doesn't just leave it there. He tells him how to do that, and he tells him what the results will be. Verse 7 and 8 says, be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the law my servant Moses gave you. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left, that you may be successful wherever you go. Do not let this book of the law depart from your mouth. Meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. In these verses, God links that strength and courage to his word, which will then lead to success. God tells Joshua to do what is written in the word, to have a singularity of focus. Do not turn to the right or to the left. Be a man consumed by the word. Meditate on the word. This instruction is also for us. I read as I studied that Charles Spurgeon once said, if you cut a believer, they should bleed Bible. That is the point that God is trying to make. Saturate yourself in my word so that it just becomes a part of you. Here's the key. First, God says, I am always with you. My presence will empower you to obey my instructions and commands. That is God's way. He always gives grace before making the commands. God's love precedes the law. God never demands that he does not first empower us in doing something. He goes before us, he shows us what to do, and then he empowers us. Be strong and courageous. This is a command that is empowered by God and God alone. It was a huge challenge for Joshua, just as it is for us today. Can we do this ourselves? No way. Can we do it with God's empowering presence with us? Yes. Will it be easy? No. Will it make us popular? Probably not. Will it make us rich? Unlikely. Will it make us prosperous and successful in God's eyes? Yes, because that's what he says right here. Now, what does this tell us about the meaning of success? I want you to know that the words prosperity and success are almost never used to speak of financial success in the Old Testament. It's not about having more money or more things. Now, I want to share with you that downstairs we've been talking about contentment in the grade 1 to 5 class. And I want you to look at the definition of contentment that we have been learning. So downstairs, when we put a slide up, we all get to say it together because that helps us to remember. So we're going to say together underneath what it says there what contentment means. Now, grade 1 to 5, you guys need to be loud and show them how we do it, okay? So let's do it together. 1, 2, 3. Deciding to be okay with what you have. Thanks, guys. Now, we have learned downstairs that stuff can't keep you happy. As we learned this truth, my friend Wyatt shared that stuff, it makes you happy to begin with, but it does not keep you happy. Those are the words and wisdom from a child in grade 1, which is amazing. The word prosper is found 59 times in the Old Testament, meaning to accomplish or succeed in one's task. The word success means to have insight, understanding, or to be wise so as to accomplish a task. Success has to do with obedience to God. That is true success. That is where you will find contentment, in the will of God. Let's look at verse 9. It says, "Have I not commanded you, be strong and courageous, do not be terrified, do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go." God repeats the command to be strong and courageous. He gives some additional instructions and clarification, and he restates his promise to be with Joshua wherever he goes. 3 times, God tells Joshua to be strong and courageous. God is not telling him to do this on his own. God tells him where to get his strength. Be in my word, study it, obey it, immerse yourself in it. Then you will be able to be strong and courageous. And that leads us to our next truth, which is that God gives us strength to obey. It's not that one. It's the one before that one. God gives us strength. I hope nobody saw that. Otherwise, you're learning what's coming next. God gives us strength to obey. Like Joshua, is God calling you to do something that seems impossible? Is your fear holding you back? Will you ask God to give you strength to obey his word? In these last few verses, we will see how God prepares his people. Joshua is energized by God's words. Joshua's immediate response is to tell the leaders of the people, to get the people ready. Let's look at verses 10 and 11. It says, "So Joshua ordered the officers of the people, go through the camp and tell the people, get your supplies ready. 3 days from now, you will cross the Jordan here to go in and take possession of the land the Lord your God is giving you for your own." So these instructions, a bit organizational and instructional, but Joshua still makes sure the people remember it is God who is giving them this land. He reminds them of God's promises. God moved among his people to accomplish his purposes. Joshua was not the only one created for and called to take possession of the land. Every person had a vital role in God's plan. And the truth here is that God uses his people to accomplish his purposes. God uses his people to accomplish his purposes. As we looked at these verses in Joshua chapter 1, the message is this: yes, Moses has died, But God has not left Israel or us alone. We still have God's promises. We still have God's presence. We still have God's word. We are God's people, and that is more than enough. How do God's promises and God's presence impact your life? God knows your situation. He knows your difficulties. We can trust God and obey him in spite of our fears. We need to soak in his word. We must rest in his promises. And we must trust in his love. He doesn't call us and then leave us to figure it out. He calls us to be strong and courageous. He tells us how. Immerse yourself in my word. Then he tells us the outcome. I will make you successful and prosperous. I will give you wisdom to accomplish the tasks that I call you to do. God promises his people strength to obey his word. As I prepared for today, one of my struggles was, what should I speak on? Right from the beginning, God gave me Joshua 1. But I spent a week or more struggling with whether that is what I should speak on, if there was something different. I started to kind of go out of control. But I was trying to be in control. That was the issue. God had directed me to Joshua 1. He sent me back there again. I woke up early one morning and just immersed myself in Joshua chapter 1. And through his word, God gave me strength and courage to obey him. He called me, he loved me, he equipped me. He knew exactly what I needed. God was in control. I think verse 9 sums it all up, and I would like to read it again. It says, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be terrified. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go." He loves us. He calls us. He equips us. He empowers us. If he is calling you somewhere today, do not be afraid. Immerse yourself in his word. Immerse yourself in his love. Know who he is. And be blessed as he makes you successful and prosperous in whatever he is calling you to do. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for your word. We thank you for these truths, Lord. We thank you for how they change our lives, Lord. They draw us closer to you. I pray that as you've spoken to each of us today, that we would hear the truth that applies directly to us, Lord. I pray that you would help us to be obedient to the call, that you would give us courage as we feel fear, Lord, that you would help us to have confidence to step out and do work for you and serve for you, Lord. We love you so much, and we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.